Now we'll be looking at the Nigerian International Environmental Law. We have looked at the various international treaties and protocol on environmental law. Nigeria is a signatory to most of these international treaties on the environment. As a matter of fact, Section 20 of the 1999 Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, as amended, states, unquote, quote, the state shall protect and improve the environment and safeguard the water, air, and land, forests, and wildlife of Nigeria, unquote. This is the first time any constitution in Nigeria recognized the function of the state over the environment. None of the previous constitutions stated anything directly on the environment like the 1999 constitution. As a matter of fact, Nigeria was asleep on its role on the environment until the dumping of the toxic waste in Cocoa Delta State in 1988. You will recall that an Italian company dumped this waste in Cocoa Village. It was that activity, it was that actually woke us from our slumber on the need for the protection, the conservation of the environment. And ever since that time, there have been renewed activities on the part of the Nigerian state on the protection of the environment. Between that time and now, there have been several efforts, particularly institutional and legal framework on the protection of the environment. For instance, a standalone Ministry of Environment had been established, which purposely is to protect and safeguard the Nigerian environment. Also, talking about regulatory framework, the National Environmental Protection Agency Act, which had been overtaken by the National Environmental Standard and Regulation Agency Act, the NESREA Act, had been in place in Nigeria. All states of the Federation too have set up their own environmental protection agencies, and also enacted, most states have enacted state environmental protection acts. Apart from the NESREA Act, there have been several other domestic legislations on the environment in Nigeria. These legislative frameworks, like we look at under the international environmental law, also took care of the Nigerian forest resources, the Nigerian water resources, the airspace, and issues of pollution had been addressed by several legislation, domestic legislation in Nigeria. What are we saying here? What we are saying here is that since the discovery of the dumping of the toxic waste in Cocoa Village in Delta State in 1988, there have been several efforts on the part of the Nigerian state, including making a provision under Section 20 of the 1999 Constitution for the improvement, for the protection, for the conservation of the environment. Also, apart from the direct provision of the Nigerian Constitution, there have been several enactments, several legislation on the protection of the environment in Nigeria. Having looked at this, the next one we'll be looking at is international criminal law. International criminal law. when we're looking at the municipal law, we said that municipal law has to do with the relationship between individual citizens and the state. So, criminal law under municipal law has to do with crime against the state. Also, under international law, there is international criminal law that addresses transborder crimes, criminal activities across state frontiers. So, international criminal law is a body of law that prohibits certain categories of conduct deemed to be serious crime. It regulates procedures governing investigation, prosecution, and punishment, and hold perpetrators individually accountable for their commission. Such criminal activities include genocide, war crimes, crimes against humanity, and so on and so forth. Article 38(1) of the 1946 Statute of ICJ embodies the sources of international criminal of international law. These include treaties, customary international law, general principle of law, judicial decisions, juristic writings. Now, it is out of this that international criminal law found expression. In other words, international criminal laws are crimes that are perpetrated against humanity. It is crimes against humanity. These are acts that are purportedly committed as part of state policies directed against civilians in times of war or peace. They are not war crimes because they are not isolated acts by individual soldiers. So, under international criminal law, there has been established the International Criminal Court, the ICC. It is governed by an international treaty called the Rome Statute. It is the world's first permanent international criminal court. It holds those responsible accountable for their crimes and helps prevent reoccurrence. A case in mind is the prosecution of the Panamanian president, Noriega, over drugs and narcotic-related issues. This was done at the International Criminal Court. And here in West Africa, we have had a president of a country taken to the International Criminal Court, although recently the conviction against him had been quashed. I'm talking about the former president of Sierra Leone. Can't remember his name now. The International Criminal Court is based in The Hague, Netherlands. So, in a nutshell, what we are expressing about international criminal law is that it is a body of law that governs regimes of criminal activities against humanity, war crimes, genocide, terrorism. These are issues that catch the attention of international criminal law. Having looked at that, we'll now be looking at international humanitarian law. International humanitarian law derives from the basic principle that an individual is entitled to certain basic rights, whether in times of peace or in time of war. That by virtue of the fact that of humanity, that any individual is entitled to certain basic rights. Under municipal law, these are called fundamental human rights. Also at the international level, the international humanitarian law recognizes that individuals are entitled to some basic rights that should not be denied him or her in peacetime and in times of war. For instance, he's entitled to protection, he's entitled to security, he's entitled to dignity and respect. Even if dead, the body is entitled to decent treatment. Humanitarian law aims at limiting human suffering in periods of armed conflict, even during war, even during armed conflict. There are certain basic rights that must be protected. Some people work in hospitals, for instance, school area. All these areas are subject to protection, even in terms of armed conflict or outright war. Human rights concern legal relationship between a state and its subjects, mostly in peacetime. Humanitarian law operates in war situation or armed conflict. Human rights in armed conflict. These are the concerns of international humanitarian law. That even when hostages are taken, when people, when combatants are taken as hostage during armed conflict, once they have been captured, once they have been arrested, at that point, they have laid down their arms, they have dropped their weapons. So, international humanitarian law recognizes that at that stage, they are entitled to some dignified treatment, to some decent treatment. The principles of international humanitarian laws are embodied in the Martins Clause. The principle of distinction between civilian and combatants, civilian objects and military objectives. Combatants are people who are actually engaged in war, who are fighting on the other side. Civilian objects, these are objects, like I said, whether peacetime or wartime, there are hospitals. In peacetime, in war times, there are schools and so on. These are objects that are entitled to some forms of civilized and decent treatment, whether in peacetime or in wartime. The principle of proportionality. The principle of proportionality that there must be proportionate measure when, even in a combatant situation, a man who is carrying a gun, there is a principle of proportionality that what is matched against him must be proportional to the weapon that he's carrying. You cannot, because an individual is carrying a gun, and go and bomb a whole community, for instance. This is what the principle of proportionality is saying. The principle of military necessity. Certain actions, certain acts connotes military necessity. When there is no need for a military warfare, for instance, then it should be avoided. That is what that principle is saying. Then, under the international humanitarian law, the Geneva Red Cross Convention of 1949 is key. The Geneva Convention for the Amelioration, it has this basic convention, four of them. Number one is the Geneva Convention for the Amelioration of the Condition of the Wounded and Sick in armed forces in the field. That's the first convention, even when combatants are on either side. Once somebody had been wounded or had become sick, this Geneva Convention made provision for the amelioration of their condition. The second of the convention is the Geneva Convention for the Amelioration of the Condition of the Wounded, the Sick, and Shipwrecked Members of the Armed Forces at Sea. The third is the Geneva Convention relative to the treatment of prisoners of war, POW. That's the third convention. That's those that are already been captured as prisoners of war, this convention makes provision for their treatment. Finally, is the Geneva Convention to the protection of civilians' persons in time of war. People who are not combatants, who are not actively engaged in armed struggle in the war situation, this Geneva Convention makes provision for their own treatment, that they must be subjected to some form of civilized treatment. Non-international conflicts. These are conflicts to life and persons in particular. Murder of all kinds of mutilation, cruel treatment, and torture. In non-international conflicts, individuals must be free from every form of violence and cruel treatment. Taking of hostages, outrages against personal dignity, humiliating and degrading treatment. Passing and carrying out of sentences without previous judgment pronounced by a regular court. So, this in this session again, we have looked at the international environmental law, we have looked at international criminal law, and we have looked at international humanitarian law. These are the fundamentals of international law. In our next contact, we'll be moving to international organizations. We'll be looking at various world bodies like the United Nations Organization. We shall be looking at regional bodies like the organization, the African Union. We shall be looking at sub-regional bodies like the ECOWAS. Thank you for listening.